So now we look at instantaneous rates of change. So we looked at the rate of change over a certain interval. For instance, in the you-do problem, we went from x equals 4 to x equals 7. What we're going to do to look at an instantaneous rate of change is we're going to look at an average rate of change at some value, let's call c, and we're just going to let our x1 or our x2, depending on how you label x1 and x2, point 1 and point 2, we're going to let this x1 get closer and closer and closer to c. And as we do that, we're going to get smaller and smaller and smaller intervals on which our average rate of change is taken. If we make those small enough, then what happens is we get an instantaneous rate of change. In order to get an instantaneous rate of change, it's nice to use the difference quotient notation. Here's why. As my point gets closer and closer and closer to C, it's nice to talk about my other x value. So we have an x value of C and another x value. So that other x value we just let be C plus H. And getting closer and closer to C means that the C plus H is getting closer and closer to C, which means the H is getting closer and closer to zero. So if we're looking for an instantaneous rate of change, I can take the limit as H goes to zero of this difference quotient. This would be the instantaneous rate of change at a value of C. Obviously, if we change the value of C to a different value, then it would be the instantaneous rate of change at that other value. So this is the instantaneous rate of change at value C. It's the limit of the difference quotient as H goes to zero. Let's look at an example for this instantaneous rate of change. We have dealt with this function f of x already, and we've looked at when x is equal to 1 and when x is equal to 3. Let's try to find the instantaneous rate of change for this function at an x value of 1. Here's my function, x squared plus 3x minus 2. I want to find the instantaneous rate of change when x is equal to 1. So what I do, well, by the rule, I'm going to take a limit of the difference quotient as h goes to 0. So I'm going to take f of my c is 1, so 1 plus h minus f of 1 divided by h. Notice that this thing, when I calculate all this out, it's going to be a function with the variable h. Now, this function here with the variable h is going to have a problem at h of 0 in the denominator because we can't divide by 0. So we can't just plug in 0 and do calculations because you would get the indeterminate form of 0 over 0. So let's plug in 1 plus h into my function. So that means I need to plug in 1 plus h into the x squared part plus into the 3x. I need to take 3 times 1 plus h into the minus 2. Well, I can just write in minus 2. So when I plug in 1 plus h into this function, I just replace every x value with a 1 plus h. So x squared plus 3x minus 2 becomes 1 plus h squared plus 3 times 1 plus h minus 2. When I plug in 1, 1 squared plus 3 times 1 minus 2 is what I get. And this kind of looks like a mess, but we're going to start cleaning it up. 1 plus h squared. I got to remember how to multiply out polynomials. 1 plus h squared becomes 1 plus 2h plus h squared when I multiply that piece out. 3 times 1 plus h, I need to distribute the 3. So 3 plus 3h. And then the minus 2 I leave alone. Hopefully everybody saw that. If you need help multiplying polynomials, go ahead and do that off to the side. So if you're thinking, well, how did I get 1 plus h squared is 1 plus 2h plus h squared? Well, multiply it out. 1 plus h times 1 plus h, 1 plus 1h plus 1h plus h times h. So that's how I got the 1 plus 2h plus h squared. All right. As you do this, I can do the whole thing at one time. 1 squared plus 3 times 1 minus 2 just becomes a 2. Now, again, if you just plug in 0, you're still going to get that indeterminate form of 0 over 0. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep trying to simplify this. So 1 plus 3 minus 2 means that when I, well, let me take a step back. I'm combining like terms in these parentheses to simplify this thing. So the h squared is by itself. When I combine the like terms of 2h and 3h, I get 5h. When I combine the like terms of 1, 3, and negative 2, I get plus 2. F of 1 is still 2. So that is my limit cleaned up. In fact, let's go one more step. Now I can combine. We have a plus 2 and a minus 2 that'll cancel each other out. So on top, we have an h squared plus 5h. And on bottom, I have an h. Now here's why those limit arguments were so important from last chapter. So earlier in the class, we took limits of functions, and we said, well, if we get an indeterminate form by just plugging in a number into the top and bottom of a rational function, that limit is going to be the same as the simplified limit. So this limit is the same as when I simplify this rational expression. Now, when I simplify this rational expression, h squared divided by h is just h. 5h divided by h is just plus 5. And now I took something that when I plugged in 0 gave me an indeterminate form to something where when I plug in 0, I get a real number. So the algebraic limit here is equal to 5. And that means the instantaneous rate of change when x equals 1 is 5. As you can see, this takes a lot of algebraic manipulation. We start by just looking at the definition of what an instantaneous rate of change is. I plug in my 1 plus h, I plug in my 1, and then on the top, I have to do a lot of multiplying and combining of like terms up until I get down to a simple version where I can actually find the limit of that function with variable h. And then I end up plugging in 0 at a point where I can get something that's not an indeterminate form. And in this case, that yielded a 5. So the instantaneous rate of change at x equals 1 is 5. You may ask, what does this all mean graphically? What are we doing with the instantaneous rate of change for this function at x equals 1? Let me try to show you graphically what's happening using this function and the x value of 1. So I have graphed this function, y equals x squared minus, or plus 3x minus 2. I've graphed that function here. And what I've done on Desmos is I've taken and I've put a couple of dots here that I can move around. And between those dots, you're always seeing a line. So let me talk about what's happening. If you remember, our first example said, let's look at the rate of change between an x value of 1 and an x value of 3. Now 3 is pretty far up there, but I think I can reach it. 3, 16, right? There we go. So you can see what happened here. The rate of change went from 1, 2 to 3, 16. That was a total gain in elevation of 14 over a distance across of 2. So the slope of this blue line is 14 over 2, which is 7. And that meant on average, going from this point to this point, on average, each time I take a step to the right, I needed to go up by 7. Now, that was the average. So notice that at each value here on the red line, we're not actually increasing at the same slope as our blue line. Up here, our slope is a little bit steeper. Up here, the slope is a little bit less steep. So when we look at rates of change, we're finding the slope between two points on a graph. As we take one point and we move it down to the other one, notice that the point that I'm keeping fixed is the point 1, 2, because that's the value of C that I'm looking at. So as I move this thing down and get closer and closer and closer, notice that as I zoom in, the blue line is looking very, very similar to what the red equation is doing at that point. So as you move closer and closer and closer, and just keep getting closer and closer and closer, you're getting better and better approximations of how fast the line is changing at this exact point. At some point when they're right on top, you would get no line at all because it doesn't make sense. But that's what's going on. So the blue and the red, the line and the graph, the curve, are basically behaving the same way in this little section. And so the slope of that line is going to be the instantaneous rate of change. You can see that the rate of change instantaneously, I can move the point, I move the point from above to below, but we should also be able to get the same thing when we move the point from below to above. In other words, I need to allow both positive and negative values for H when I look at my limit. So that's the idea. Just so that you know, you can do this at any value that you want. If I wanted to put the value of X at 0 and then move the other point closer to that value, I can say, well, where does the slope of the line get to when I get really, really, really close? When I get really, really, really close, the slope of that line is going to determine the instantaneous rate of change. And just so that you know, the lines where the two points are apart from each other, those are called secant lines. And as you get closer and closer and closer and closer, the instantaneous line you get is called the tangent line.